like, it's time for bed. I'm not tired. I don't want to stay up. I'm not tired. Like, you're tired. I don't want to go to bed. And I was like, okay, you have a choice. Do you want to brush your teeth, put on your pajamas and go to bed, or do you want to spank it? Then he stood there. Like 3 minutes, I'm like, did you hear me? He goes, after the spanking, can I stay up?
Welcome to the Focus on the Family broadcast, helping families thrive.
When times are hard, it's important to enjoy some laughter, and that's what we have in store with our guest today, Kenn Kington. Kenn's a very popular comedian and motivational speaker, and has quite a knack for finding the humor in everyday moments with his wife and three kids. So I know you're really going to enjoy his message. Here's Kenn Kington from his DVD called Wow Moments on today's Focus on the Family.
A big welcome to Kenn Kington.
Getting old is not easy, but I gotta tell you, and in marriage is wonderful. I love being married. It's not easy, but it's worth it. Hey, anybody, any newlyweds here tonight? Any newlyweds married less than a year? Anybody? Oh, that's awesome. You should be proud of it. I love being around newlyweds. They're just, oh, I love you. I love you so much. I love you so much. No, I love you more. I love you more. Just when you're gone, I can't breathe. It's just like, it's like my heart's gone. It's like he's going to work. He's coming home. All right. It's okay. And then you go to the stage. We're in the stage now where it's like we're seeing the differences, and that little 5% that's different can drive you crazy. I'm OCD. My wife's like, you are so OCD. OCD. I mean, and I am. My clothes are all in the right order and it's different colors, and I can't go by the sink where there's a dish. Oh, the dish. I gotta wash the dish. And there's some good side effects. Ladies, I wash the dishes at my house. Okay? Yeah, I know. I vacuum without being asked. Okay. So try to contain yourself, because I wash and soften and dry and fold and iron all the laundry at my house. Now I'm fully aware that I am below average looking, but for women over 30, I may have just become one of the sexiest men alive. I did that at a show a couple weeks ago. Women were throwing clothes on the stage. I don't think they were turned on, and I think they were going, iron this! Wash this! Well, if I have OCD, my wife has a condition I have termed GILD, get it later disorder. We'll get it later. I didn't have time. We'll get it later. Later seems to never come. Get it later. And it's dangerous. Went to the bathroom one night. She had left her drawer out. Just, oh, man. Woke up the next day, she goes, what was that noise last night? What was that noise? I said, you left your drawer out. I cut my leg. She goes, oh, I didn't have time. Like, what do you mean you didn't have time? I didn't have time. I was in a hurry. I didn't have time. I said, what? I tell you, get your stuff. Okay, get your iPhone, put it on the stopwatch. Ready? Time this. How long was that? Let's do it again. Ready? How long? And you know, it was a little frustrating. I had a cough one night, walk downstairs, go to get a glass, go to open the cupboard. It was dark. I went to open it. I missed it because it was open. I just went, boom. Oh. Wake up the next morning in a pool of blood on my pillow. She said, what happened to you? I said, you left the cupboard door. I didn't have time. I didn't even get to finish. You didn't leave the cupboard. Oh. And it can be so easy to get frustrated with those little pieces, but I don't, because that's 95% of the time. She's incredible. I love the little pieces. God has blessed me with. My wife has a condition. 4-0 student, language arts teacher, and yet she will mix up words all the time. And it's just entertaining. we're having a disagreement in the middle of this agreement. We don't fight really hard anymore. It's just disagreement. She goes, okay, listen. Listen, you say potato, I say tomato. It's the same thing. It's really not. It's not even close. And then there's times I don't even know what she's talking about. She goes, I'm just telling you, that just broke the last straw. Is that good? Bad? We're driving, she wanted to throw an idea at me. She goes, no, I don't want you to make a decision. I'm not saying we have to do it. I just want to put a bug in your ear to chew on. She said, what does that look for?
I said, I don't really eat bugs.
And I can't chew with my ears. And I said, this is one of my favorites. And if you follow any of the Twitter or anything, I actually tweet out my favorites because everybody knows one of these people who does this. And I love this. One of my favorites guys said the other day, he's with a colleague, and his colleague goes, hey, man, next week, let's touch base. No. Why not, man? It's important. I just need to touch face. No. And this is one of my favorites of last year. This lady calls her sister, new job, calls her, how's your new job? I hate it. Why do you hate your new job? My boss, he's always breathing down my throat. I would hate that job too. And I love this one. This only happened a couple weeks ago. A guy said he was in a meeting, got heated, and this guy in his meeting goes, you know what? I just want to let you know, you just insulted my ignorance. I would live for that. Well, I can assure you I did not mean to insult your ignorance. I fully intended to validate your ignorance. And then there's the extremes. Another lady said her dad had a spot on his hand, called her mom, hey, how's dad's spot? She goes, oh, I don't think it's anything, but made him a doctor's appointment next week anyway. I'm going to go have him get an autopsy. Not very optimistic there, are we? But I love that about my wife, and I need my wife. I don't really love her, I need her, because we have children. I tell you this, my least favorite phrase as a dad, I might have. Last February, it was cold last February. I'm driving my sons to school when I hear out of the back seat, uh-oh. What do you mean, uh-oh?
I might have forgot something.
You might have forgot something. Now I want to just take a little poll here. Someone on this side of the room here, February, driving to school, he might have forgotten what? Coat. Very good. Very good. Backpack. Very good. I thought of those as well. That wasn't it, but those are good guesses. Someone over here just, I might have forgotten. Who said shoes? Do you know my son? He said, I might have forgot my shoes. I said, well, look on your feet. Do you see shoes on your feet?
No, sir.
At what point do you walk outside? Across a cold concrete floor and not have the thought,
there's nothing on my feet.
Amazing. And it didn't stop there. It's just ongoing. A week later, my wife told my kids, grab your shoes, get in the car, we're going to eat dinner out tonight. My son's in the living room. I said, did you hear your mother?
Yes, sir.
Go get your shoes.
I don't know where they are. I said, I'll give you a hint. They're not on the ceiling. Go get your shoes. I don't know where they are. I asked him, where's the last place you put them? He did not say anything, but the look on his face was like, well, Yoda, if I knew that, I would go get them. I have a college education, and I am sucked into this conversation. I asked the dumbest question known to man. I said, where is the last place you remember having them?
On my feet.
Amazing. Amazing. This is the same son. He lives in his room's in the basement. In the basement, he's got his room. I go down there to see him one day. He is on the couch in this quilt cocoon. You can see just a little bit of his eyes. You see this much of his eyes, quilt, fingers holding an Xbox controller. I said, man, it is freezing down here. And I hear out of the quilt,
I know, right?
I said, why don't you turn the heat up?
I don't know how.
I said, let me get this right. You can operate 27 buttons. Save the world. But that box on the wall with the buttons in the shape of arrows, that confuses you.
I know, right?
But I absolutely love him. He's a great student, great little athlete, good kid. And out of nowhere, he'll just come up with something. About a month and a half ago, he's like, Dad, are you going on tour in Florida anytime? I'm like, yeah, I go there a few times. You go to Orlando, can I go? I'm like, sure, man, you can go. I said, why do you want to go to Orlando?
I want to go to SeaWorld.
I'm like, dude, you really didn't like SeaWorld as a kid. He goes, I know, I just want to walk around and see people's reaction. So what do you mean, a reaction? He goes, I'm taking a fishing pole. Well, there's something about life that don't get distracted by all the stuff out there. What is really important? And those thoughts go through my mind. What's really important? And I learned this through my kids a lot. God shows me this through my children. About a year later, they were in bed one night. My boys shared a room, and we lived downstairs, and their room was upstairs. And in the middle of the night, 3 a.m, I hear, Daddy! 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 Thought he was sick. I run up the stairs. I walk in. He is standing on his bed. Standing on his bed like a superhero. Daddy!
Daddy!
I said, dude, what are you doing? He went, Daddy. And like he'd been rehearsing this or something. 3 a.m, he goes, Daddy, I want chocolate milk now, please. What? I said, dude, it's night time. And he looked at me like, maybe he didn't hear this right. I'm standing up, I should get on my knees. He drops to his knees. Daddy,
I want chocolate milk now, please.
Like, dude, it's night time. I said, you gotta go to bed. And he looks at me, and the look on his face is like, what part of this do you not get? I'm saying all the right words. And I lay him down, and he's like, Daddy, I want chocolate milk, please. And I was like, dude, I will get you all the chocolate milk you want in the morning. But right now, it's night time. And he put his head on the pillow, and he turned up, and he went, chocolate milk, please. I said, no, buddy, it's night time. And he rolled over, and he went, okay, Daddy. And he went to sleep. And as I walked down the steps, it was one of those moments. Now, God has never spoken to me audibly. Never heard that. But it was between conscious, unconscious, that part of the soul where you're just like, I know this is something more than me. And God just whispered, Ken, that's the way I want you to be. I want you to ask for anything. And just know that I'm only going to give you what's best when it's best. And I was just like, I literally stopped on the stairs that night. I just went, oh, wow. And see, not only do I want to recognize those moments, I want to recognize the moments as they're happening. And I need help with that too. And I ask God all the time, God, help me not miss these moments. I'm driving my son to practice last year. I get to coach him. I love coaching basketball. We're driving to pull up to a red light. And my son goes, Dad. I'm like, whoa. 14 years old. I'm like, man, that's unbelievable. It's a brand new Maserati right next to us. And he goes, Dad, how fast do you think it'll go? I'm like, I don't know. And he says, how much do you think? I was, oh my God, I'm not sure. And then it hit me, Ken, this is a moment. And I said, you know what? I could have one of those. He said, really? And I'm like, yes. And I said, I could have one paid for. And he's like, really? I said, yes. I said, you know why I don't? He said, why? I said, you. I said, you are the reason I don't have one. And he went, oh, man. I said, no, not all, man. I said, dude, I wouldn't trade you for 10 Maseratis. You're unbelievable. You're incredible. You can applaud that, yeah. And I saw him well up, like, whoa. And I'm like, you're way better than a Maserati. You better than 10. That car's getting old. You're getting better. We can hang out together. You can feed yourself. You don't poop in your pants anymore. Dude, you're awesome. You are awesome. And I got to tell you, though, I'm stunned he made it. I really am. Because he's got an older brother, 11 months older. And he made it through some tough times. Because my older son, I'll never forget this. My oldest son was probably just about 2. So he was just about 10, 11 months. And you remember those little bouncy seats? Those little bouncy, you put the baby in the bouncy seat? Cody was in one of those, and it got really quiet. When you have babies, quiet is not good. I walked around the corner. There's my oldest son straddled over the bouncy seat with a bag of cheese puffs, stuffing them into Cody's mouth. He's got like 10 cheese puffs. Oh, oh. And he'd put one in and go, bing, bing, bing. Poor kid's going, ha, 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 ha. I ran over, I'm like, Graham, Graham, stop. He goes, he like it. And I don't know if you have children that are close in age, and it's normal, they don't get along all the time. And we have a very simple discipline, like if you can't get along, you sit on the steps. Sit on the steps. A fate worse than death. Sit on the steps. And they would just say, oh, man, 5 minutes seems like an eternity to like a 5-year-old. I was walking down the hall one day, and out of the room where they shared, I hear this major thud. Just I'm like, that can't be good. So I start walking down the hall to investigate. And right before I get to the doorway, I hear my second son sniffling, and my oldest son going, I didn't mean to, man. I didn't mean to, man. He said, we don't want to sit on the steps, man. We don't want to sit on the steps. And I hear Cody, he's like, I know, man, just give me a minute. Just give me a minute. And the older one to cheer him on, he's like, take the pain, man. Take the pain. Hear that when you're 6 years old. Wow. I'm surprised they survive. I really am. And then I remember we were reading these books when they were born. Read the books. Put them on a schedule. We did that. That worked great. We read it. Said, let them make choices. Let them make choices early and often. And let them find out through failure and learn through failure. Let them make choices. When the earlier they are, make the choices obvious. 4 years old, my oldest son came in. He was exhausted one night. It's time for bed. I'm not tired. I'm not tired. Like, you're tired. And I thought, great part for a choice. I said, now, I said, you have a choice. Would you like to put on your pajamas and brush your teeth and go to bed? Or would you like a spanking? He sat there, he's like, I'm doing pajamas and go to bed. Like, that's a great choice. That is the choice I would have made. Good choice. If you have children, you know they're different. 11 months later, my second son, he turns 4, and he's had a night, he's exhausted, he's staggering, he's so tired. It's like, it's time for bed. I'm not tired, I don't want to stay up, I'm not tired. Like, you're tired. I don't want to go to bed. And I was like, okay, you have a choice. Do you want to brush your teeth, put on your pajamas and go to bed, or do you want to spank it? And he stood there. Like 3 minutes, I'm like, did you hear me? He goes, after the spanking, can I stay up? Years later, we have a little girl. How many of you have little girls? Wow. They are different. She hits 4. She's on the verge of tears. She's so quiet. She's tired. So, like, you're tired. You need to go to bed. It's past your bedtime. I don't want to go to bed. Well, you're tired. You need to go to bed. I don't want to go to bed. Okay. You have a choice. Do you want to put on your pajamas and brush your teeth and go to bed, or do you want to spank it? She put her finger in my face. No! I don't think that's one of the choices. And I love spontaneity. My wife is so spontaneous. I've learned a lot about spontaneity. I tell you, I can be spontaneous. Just let me know 24 hours in advance. Let me plan for it. My sons were young. Their first sporting event ever was going to be soccer. And they were going to play their first soccer games. I was not going to miss it. I had a show in Los Angeles. Walked out of the show, got in the car, went to the LAX. Got in LAX, flew all night. Got landed, drove straight home, got out of my car, into the minivan. Pew! Straight to the soccer field. Made it with 3 minutes to spare. I literally went, God, thank you. Thank you so much that I got to their game. I said, are you guys ready for soccer? And they're like, yeah. I said, let's go. And Heather, my wife, she goes, well, I'm waiting just a minute. I need to tell you something. I'm like, well, can you tell me on the sideline? Because they got to go. They're going to be late. She goes, no, I need to tell you before we go out. I can't wait. She goes, no, I got to tell you this real quick. I said, well, make it fast because they're going to be late. She goes, okay, they might think that you are the coach. Why on earth would they think I'm the coach? I've never played soccer a day in my life. And I said, I've never met these people. I might have signed you up. Would be an important detail. There are moments. There are just those moments in life. And I tell you, I love those moments. We were actually, when the boys were small, we took them to Disney World. I don't know if you've ever seen this or not, but the Breakfast with the Characters. Have you seen that? It's where you pay like $40 for cold eggs. And you're sitting there eating and wondering why you paid $40 for cold eggs. And these big furry people walk out. It's awesome. Last day we were there, we decided we want a memento, a memory. And we took them to downtown Disney, took them to a souvenir shop. They had this wall, huge wall of stuffed animals. And they're just like, whoa. I said, you can get one of anything. My oldest son went into shopper's trauma. I want this one. I want this one. I want this one. I want... And like eight of them going. I watched him freak out. And then I watched Cody. Cody was right down here to my right. I'm watching Graham do spinning drills and Cody's standing right there. Now, Disney makes most of their stuffed animals gender neutral. They make a few that are masculine in nature. To my knowledge, they only make one that is feminine in nature. And that is Duchess the Cat. My rough and tumble Cody is standing here holding Duchess. I said, what are you doing there, buddy? I want a kitty. I said, you want a kitty? And he goes, I want a kitty. I'm like, what? You, Tigger. Tigger's a cat. You love Tigger. No, I want a kitty. The Lion King. You love Lion King. Roar. And he's like, I want a kitty. Every time I made a suggestion, it got closer and tighter. And he held on for dear life. I'm like, oh, it's your choice. He loved this cat. He kept this cat for years. And he never wavered. He loved this cat. I'm like, okay, you got the kitty, all right. And I'll never forget, we came home. 2 weeks later, I went to tuck him in to bed. And I always love to pray over my kids when they're little. I always pray and I'd touch the different parts. I would just pray. I'm like, God, give him wisdom beyond their days. And I'd touch their head. Give him a heart of compassion. Give them arms that reach out to others. Give them legs that walk in the truth. But Lord, please, please most of all, Lord, give them joy. And I would just tickle them till they cannot breathe. And when they couldn't handle it anymore, they would go, my joy takes fall. My joy takes fall. And I would go, Lord, thank you for giving them joy. And I walked in. I said, Cody, it's time for bed. And he was kneeling on his bed, and I walked in, and he's got his back to the door. I said, buddy, hop into bed. Time for bed. He goes, Daddy, come here. And I walked around. And there's Duchess laying on his bed with his little green blanket over her. And he goes, Daddy, watch. And he leaned over and he goes, I pray the head and the heart and the legs. Joy, 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 joy. And he said, look, Daddy, I'm the dad. Said, you can keep the cat. Oh, it's just, yes. Yes.
What a priceless moment from Kenn Kington. And this is a fun message, but Ken made an important point with that last story. Children mimic us. And Cody was repeating the prayer that he'd heard his dad say with him every night. And I think that's a great reminder for us as parents. Your children are watching you. Let them see you being a faithful follower of Christ. That's one of the best things you can do for them. And the best place to start is to pray with them. And we'll have some articles on how to do that at our website. And if you need someone to pray with you, please give us a call and let our staff meet that need in your life. We'd be honored to do it. And I know times are tough right now, but if you can give to the Ministry of Focus on the Family, please do so. We'll send you a DVD of Ken's message with over an hour of content for a donation of any amount. And if you can't make a donation, just let us know and we'll trust others are going to cover that cost. We just want to get this comic relief into your hands.
And our phone number is 800, the letter A and the word family. You can click on the link below as well to request that DVD from Ken. And to find a lot of helpful articles on prayer as well. On behalf of Jim Daly and the entire team here, thanks for joining us today for this episode of Focus on the Family. I'm John Fuller, inviting you back as we once more help you and your family thrive in Christ.